the gay and lesbian community was bar oriented, you know, when I got here in the late 70s, and that was how you got all your information. So that was the central focus place. But when Mom Guess What started, a whole world opened up. You could find a gay boxing league or bowling league. You could find a softball team. You could find
volleyball.
A gay or lesbian therapist. You could find an accountant. Opened up a whole world, and you knew when events were. Before, if something happened or if somebody died or something bad was going on, you picked up the information at the gay bars. You know, the Mercantile Saloon was the big information place. And it still is, probably. But Mom Guess What opened up a whole different level. Now, I had finished my psychiatry training. I was trained in community mental health, where we worked on getting mental health out to the community. So we worked on tiers where we had peers working, we had mental health workers, we had psychiatrists, we had a whole outreach. And that was my background. So Mom Guess What would announce things that were going to happen. And this was something new. And I put on two conferences, one for lesbian mental health issues and one for gay men's health issues. And I remember at that conference, this was our first glimmer. Robert Miller was a gay physician, and this is before we really knew about AIDS, but something was brewing. And he said, "Something is going on. I have felt ill for a long time, and I don't know what it is, and I don't know if it's contagious, but I've stopped having sex with other men." That was all he had sex with. And he put out a warning. And one of the other doctors who was attending jumped all over him for trying to spread fear. And then another doctor mentioned to me, he says, "Well, I'm seeing a lot of cytomegalovirus infections, and I'm kind of keeping a list." So this was the first glimmer. And Mom Guess What, of course, announced these conferences, because now we could have conferences for gay people, you know, educational events. Well, then Mom Guess What announced that Cleve Jones was coming to town. We were going to have a candlelight vigil for people who were gay, who'd been lost at that time. It was,
and he wrote for us for a while, and yeah. He was the founder of the
MAMES Project.
Yeah,
wonderful
the quilts.
Man. Wonderful man.
Yes.
And he was speaking, and I think this was probably late 82, early 83, and he was saying, "There's something going around, there's infections going around, we have some unusual pneumonias, we think we have some Kaposi sarcoma, we think something's happening. We've started a foundation in San Francisco, and we need to start now doing something." So I was inspired. I probably had a little less denial than the men had, maybe because it wasn't quite so direct. And I thought we had to do something. So I enrolled two other gay physicians, Sandy Pomerantz and Harvey Thompson, and we decided to start an AIDS foundation. And we sat in front of K Street, one of the gay bars, collecting money, and somebody donated a trip to Hawaii, and we raised enough money to start an AIDS foundation.
Denny had a lot to do with it.
Norm Frohwein wasn't working at the time, and he agreed to work at the front desk. And we were the education source. And we also knew we had the Shanti Foundation in San Francisco that provided services to people who had life-threatening illnesses or were dying, and their loved ones. So I went up there and trained with them. Jackson Payton was somebody I met in town, a social work student, and he'd done the Shanti training, so I went up there and did the Shanti training, and then I started recruiting people, which required Mom Guess What? Volunteers needed for emotional support for people with AIDS. And it was the Kaposi Sarcoma Foundation at first, because we didn't have the terms HIV. We didn't know it was a virus. There was a lot we didn't know. So we started the hand-to-hand project, and that involved recruiting, in addition to recruiting volunteers, recruiting nurses like Dick Jaco and a social worker like Tom Richardson, other people with special expertise, so they could. We then divided the volunteers into groups, so they had these group leaders who had more background and provided them backup for what turned out to be a very hard course for us. I think in 1990, when I left, we probably had 260-some volunteers. We started out doing emotional support, but then it turned out we couldn't get home care for people with AIDS, and they weren't allowed into nursing homes. So we trained practical support volunteers, and we taught them how to change bedding with people in it, how to do wheelchair transfers, how to bed bathe people. It was pretty intense. So we had those volunteers too. And then Mom, Guess What was also a good port to educate people about HIV. And early on, being that the government wasn't getting involved and we didn't have a lot of great information, we thought the incubation period was 18 months. So it was decrease your number of sex partners, then it was use a condom, then it was be mutually monogamous for at least 18 months. And then the hepatitis B cohort study came out in 84. And in that study, they found out it was incubating for 10 years. That, what was it, in 1978, a good 20%, 14 to 20% already had the virus in that cohort from San Francisco. So that was shocking. Sandy and Harvey and Neil Flynn, Sandy Pomerantz and Harvey Thompson and Neil Flynn started a clinic at UCD Med Center, and we were seeing people there. Doctors did not want to see these patients. Then we had a major, early 1985, we were able to get local people tested at the Med Center. It was before the test became commercially available. And what was really awful was a lot of our volunteers started testing positive. And then Dr. Thompson died of AIDS. Later, Dr. Pomerantz died. So we were losing kind of the cornerstones of our health care. We still had Neil Flynn at the Med Center. But it was a devastating blow, particularly with Harvey, because he was such a cornerstone of the gay community, and he was our own gay doctor, our first real gay doctor, and people loved him dearly. Mom, Guess What paid beautiful tribute to him. We had a beautiful, huge service, and announced in Mom, Guess What, of course, so we could gather together. And Mom, Guess What also became where we would have obituaries and obituaries. And obituaries. There were so many people dying. We didn't have AZT yet. I remember once at one of the hospitals I was doing, I would do psych consults for Harvey and Sandy. So they were so overburdened. I'd come around and be the psychiatrist, and I'd do the emotional support. I'd find them volunteers. I'd deal with their families. And families could be challenging too. We started getting volunteers from St. Francis Church. And if we had a real difficult situation, say over at Sutter, with a family that wasn't coping well, I could call and Brother Angelo might come scooting over across Sutter Park and help out because he was a volunteer. So we started to have the death of the volunteers and the death of the clients, and it just really blew up. And we're at this point, so many people were caught unsuspected. It seemed like Didn't it seem like about half the men we knew died at that time?
Oh, at least, yeah.
AZT came along, and that was a blessing. I remember as a psychiatrist watching that helped reverse dementia. That was pretty exciting. Other things that were going on, when Harvey died, he'd been the main educator. And when he was sick, he gave me his slideshow. So I had to take over the medical slideshow. So I was taking my slideshow on the road all over the place and starting to do medical stuff. And then I got involved in American Association of Physicians for Human Rights. It was a gay physicians group. And we were pushing to get drugs into trials and try to save lives. So there we would meet with Jim Curran from from CDC. We met with our beloved Anthony Fauci, meeting with people from all NIH, trying to work to get the drugs to the people. And I remember we had one conference back in Boston, and I remember some people from the AIDS Foundation were there too. And ACT UP showed up. And Frank Young was the head of the FDA at that time. And he was wearing his public health uniform. And they started, ACT UP started their action. They had a big hand with a finger pointing down at him. And then they all stood up. They were spread out in the audience. And they were wearing black, and they held up watches that were ticking. And time was running out. And Frank Young came over to the edge of the stage, and he sat down, and he said, "What can I do?" And from that point forth, he worked on trying to get the drugs to the people faster, community trials. He did all those things. And then I think he lost his job over some fruit or vegetables from South America. I can't remember, but he had a lot of things he had to do. So, again, Mom, guess what was key in educating people in our grieving and keeping the community together? At the same time, never forgetting the lesbians, because there was also lesbian coverage. At the same time all this was going on, I was involved with my lesbian doctors group, which I've been involved with since 1984. And we had a small core group of lesbian doctors who were treating AIDS patients, and we were really tight because our issues were really somewhat different because we weren't a part of the same camaraderie the men had. But we nevertheless were on the front lines. And these were the people, these were the doctors who were seeing the poor people too, because the women tended to work in county and the lower paying jobs. So that was my experience with Mom, Guess What? And how it made a difference. The other thing that was really nice, I didn't mention SAGA, the gay games.
Yeah.
My brother and brother-in-law, Mark Harrison and Norm Frohwein, were key in starting these sports groups that competed in the Gay Olympics, which got sued and they couldn't use the term Gay Olympics.
Yeah.
So they had to become Gay Games. But, you know, we sent all sorts of athletes. Norm did physique and Mark did track and got a gold medal. And Anna, my partner, did, wife at this time, but partner then, she won something in tennis. But it was really exciting things that you could get people together for all sorts of wonderful things. So I think that I don't know how that would have happened. And Mom, Guess What? Was very unique. Linda is kind. They didn't go after people. They didn't do cruel exposés. They were good. And that was wonderful. It elevated people and it brought people together. I credit Linda with that. And that's no small task in a paper. I know a couple other papers started and stopped and tried to be more muckraking. And not Linda's paper. It was just kind and wonderful. before the paper, I was involved with the Women's Center, so the lesbians knew how to find me. And then going to the Mercantile Saloon, I knew a lot of the gay men, and I have a gay brother. So I kind of knew everyone, and everyone knew me, but there were many other therapists who weren't visible. I certainly couldn't see everyone. You know, I had a private practice. I always had to work somewhere else to make some money, because like when you're treating a community, you aren't going to drive people to the poorhouse to get help. And I'd see my AIDS patients, and they'd run out of health insurance, they'd run out of money. So it was, but it provided links to all the other social workers and psychologists and other professionals in the community. What was Ed's last name? Ed was the psychologist who... He did a group for... He did support groups with men with HIV.
I want to say Klinghoffer, but that's not right.
Yeah, well, we forget that name. Sorry, I forget Ed's name. But it allowed people to find help. It was even matters of finding an attorney when you know you're going to die and you want your partner to be taken care of. You know, finding an accountant who will be sympathetic. Not everybody was terribly sympathetic to us then. You know, I mean, it showed that. I remember after Harvey died, sitting and calling around to see what Sandy's Pomerantz's practice filled, calling around trying to get doctors to see people. It was hard. You know, thank goodness Neil had opened the clinic at the Med Center. But it was, I remember being so shocked that we couldn't get people into nursing homes till later. I mean, what do you do when people are bedridden? What do you do if they live alone? You know, it was harrowing times. And we could not have done it without this volunteer force.
There were a lot.
And this is how we got them, Mom, guess what? And I tell you, the first group that showed up, then we weren't even sure how it was spread. You know, that was back when we were nervous if we'd grabbed somebody else's cigarette by mistake or grabbed somebody else's drink by mistake. And the first group that came were the most altruistic men I have ever met. I'm still friends with some of them. They were just outstanding people. And then there were the people with hemophilia. Remember one of the things that happened at the AIDS Foundation that was so striking to me, and Norm said he had a call, would I take it? And it was a guy saying, I'm getting this factor that's made from blood products. I have hemophilia. Do I need to be worried? And so I got in touch with the hemophilia clinic at UCD, and the woman who I spoke to said, you leave our people alone. Which was pretty shocking. But then we got a volunteer, Brent, who he had hemophilia, but he was also the one who delivered the clotting supplies and the factor VIII to the kids with hemophilia around the state. We got Gay, who was a mother of someone with hemophilia. We got these wonderful volunteers from that community who could spread the word there. So I was on their little board, and that was another place to get information out. At one point, you could use your double sources. The people at the FDA devices unit, they had gotten a brochure they'd put together on condom use, and they couldn't get it out. They couldn't get it approved. So they slipped it to the hemophilia group. And then we could start putting it everywhere. It was just a little animated cartoon, but things like that were going on. But eventually, you know, we had friends. You know, we had friends in the FDA. We had good friends there. Some of them volunteered at the Whitman Walker Clinic in Washington, D.C., the doctors and nurses there. I mean, people really started to care, and that made a big difference.
So how would you, describing what was happening here in Sacramento, and you've given some very specific instances, but with the onset of AIDS and the reaction to the community as a whole. So Mom Guess What was publishing material to connect people. And and we know that more than just gay people were reading that newspaper.
Right.
So kind of addressing the role that that plays in public information and the role that a newspaper can play in trying to explain what AIDS is. Because nobody understood, just like the beginning of COVID, they didn't understand what
and
it was.
With AIDS, the gay community had to do it by themselves. Fortunately, the gay doctors got access, but we had to do it ourselves. The government wasn't there. It was really, you know, at least with COVID, there were scientists involved, but here, you know, we were just struggling to. We didn't know how it was spread. We didn't know what to tell people. We're doing the best to tell them what we could. Looking back, there was some misinformation there. You know, the 18-month incubation, you know. We struggled with that.
You know, with the readership of MGW, one of the readers was Ann Rudin, who was a nurse and also our mayor.
She's wonderful.
For a long time. And she was turned into a really good friend, but she would read MGW to learn about AIDS. I mean, she would call and talk to us about it, and Sonia Cox was our AIDS editor, and the two of them were pretty tight. And after a while, when she learned a whole bunch, she helped with that page, too, just like Elizabeth did. Everybody proofread all the stuff, so we didn't get things wrong. But a lot of straight people got the message through MGW.
Very accurate reporting. Even what to do about your pet if you had HIV. Mm. Early on, they'd say, get rid of your cat, get rid of your dog. And the wonderful group, Pets Are Wonderful Support from the Bay Area, that could get us if we had a nice vet there. We got good information on how and what the issues were with keeping a pet. No, you didn't have to get rid of them. You just change the box with your gloves on or don't breathe the, you know, there were things to do, but little things like that. And Harvey wrote a medical column for a long time.
Yeah, Harvey wrote for a long time, too.
Harvey
Sandy
Thompson,
did,
the doctor,
too. Sandy Pomerantz,
Sandy
Pomerantz
did,
a lot.
Too.
Oh, but and their photographs were in the paper a lot. You know, if there were meetings and conferences, you know, we would shoot pictures of all these guys, you know, up at the, on the stage, you know, on our platform, answering questions and, you know, talking to different people, making them feel better about what was going on, or trying to make them feel better.
It was such a tragedy to lose both of them.
Yeah.
They were my good friends.
Yes. Harvey was a very real close friend of mine. I think I've told you, he and I would ride our bicycles down to Capitol Nursery. We lived real close together. We'd buy all these plants and tie them to the bikes. And he had two Scotty dogs, and I've always had Schnauzers. So the Scotties would be in his basket, and my Schnauzers would be in my basket, and all these flowers. Then we go to my house first, and we plant everything up in the whole yard. And then we go to his house and plant everything up. And then we'd make a huge dinner and invite friends and show them everything we did. And it was a ritual that he and I did, and it was, I missed a lot. And yeah. It was really hard to lose him.
Yeah. I remember I was sitting at his bedside when he was dying, and he was in pain. And he asked the nurse for more medicine, and she said, it's not time yet. So he picked up the phone and called the doctor. I said, this is Dr. Thompson. Would you please tell the nurse to give me some more pain medicine? But I just remember sitting with him, and then the sunbeam came in. We were at Mercy, and he said, you look beautiful in the sunbeam. It was just this moment, and then he left us. And I don't think we'll ever recover from that, because he was a Green Beret before he was a doctor.
Yeah.
He was a fabulous man. But yeah, we lost many wonderful people.
We were constantly...
Oh, and testing laws. Oh, we had meetings about testing, privacy, anonymity. A lot of people wanted testing to be just like any, a lot of medical people wanted testing to be just like any other lab test. You order a test. And we fought and fought, and I guess Stan was with Roberti's office since. And we worked it out, and all the reasons you needed anonymous testing, otherwise people would not get tested. And we worked on that too, and that was another gathering, working with Mom Guess What, and educating people about anonymity. And
a lot of people were getting fired from their jobs, remember?
Yeah.
Herb Finger, he was a chef.
That was so sad.
And he worked with Biba, and then he was a chef at Bon Appetit, which was Biba's first restaurant. And then they closed that. And so then he went to Rayleigh's and was the meat counter ordering person. But then Tom Rayleigh got wind that he was there and he was gay, and he went into the meat department and washed Harvey using knives and having, you know, meat blood all over the place. And he was afraid it was Harvey's blood, and Herb's, and he fired Herb right on the spot.
We had to, you know, with the American Association of Physicians for Human Rights, we had to start a subgroup for physicians with HIV because there was the whole issue of job security there too, because if it got out that a dentist or doctor had HIV, there was, oh my God, people will sue us.
And the dental people, that was hard. Dental people had it really hard.
Yeah, and surgeons.
And surgeons.
Surgeons, yeah.
So Linda, at the paper, did you have a stated policy of your point of view on AIDS, or an objective that you had set in place for the covering of AIDS?
No, nothing printed or on paper, or probably just more in my head and with all my friends, and you know.
You just did it all.
Yeah, I just did it, you know.
And kept it scientifically sound. Yeah.
And I had a little bit of a science background with getting a degree in psych, you know, studies and stuff like that. So I knew a little bit about some of those things. And I just always tried to stay middle of the road and make sure that we checked out our facts. So we're, especially with AIDS, we're getting the right facts out to people. Because everybody's confused and upset and worried that they're going to die, and how are they going to survive, and parents that were going nuts, you know, what are we going to do with our son? I remember David Weiner's parents. Remember David? He was one of my editors. He died early on, but his parents came into my office a couple times and brought a whole bunch of David's things in boxes. And, I mean, they were crying, and it was hard.
You just don't know how bad it was. And you kept going, you kept covering everything, you know? Because in addition to, you know, like me, you were losing friends as you were trying to keep this paper going.
We were going to funerals all the time. And I figured it out at one point I had gone to 210 funerals, and it was probably a lot more than that after I quit counting.
I remember I was working at a student health center, and the medical staff was frightened. So I was doing an educational thing, and I was asking, well, do you have any patients with hemophilia here? And what do they do after they inject? They throw it in the trash. And, you know, about 90% of the people with severe hemophilia A, unfortunately, got the virus. And that kind of was a thought check for a lot of people, that the people with hemophilia were getting it too. You know, a heterosexual person could say, they're like me. Oh my God. And that community really came around, and I think they made a difference too in fear. But when you talk to healthcare workers, that was often the thing that shook them a bit when you mentioned hemophilia, and what did they do with their works after they injected their factor.
It was also interesting to me that so many women rose to the occasion to help. Either help directly someone that was sick at home and needed care at home, because it's so hard to find other people to help. But a lot of lesbians came up to the plate and started their own groups and were writing things and doing and cooking for the men.
Volunteering.
They had meals that they were taking around in cars to everybody, and because straight people weren't helping us, we had to do it ourselves.
And I think a lot of, maybe this is my bias, I think a lot of people kind of stuck up their noses at lesbians, you know, as, oh, they're kind of a afterthought of the gay community. And even some gay men, I remember we had to go into a men's bar, we had to show 3 picture IDs. So there was some prejudice there, but you know, these women who came forth, they were shy women, they were state workers, they were students, they were housewives, grandmothers, they came forward and they volunteered and they took care of those men, and they were wonderful. And then we got the women with HIV and the men took care of them. I mean, what a group. The gay community really came
through. I remember this one woman called and she said, you know, we've been helping the gay men with AIDS for years now, and now I have cancer and I'm really sick and I need help. And so I just talked to her for a long time, like, what kind of help do you need? And she said, I need somebody to clean my pool and help with the cats and dog bathing and stuff. So anyhow, I just started calling around and got a whole bunch of people to help her. They just showed up at her house and she was overwhelmed. But then that kind of got going and it became an organization of people that, you know, to help.
And I think you also were increasing breast cancer awareness and breast cancer support groups through the newspaper, because we had a lot of that too.
And a lot of things were turning around too. A lot of men would help women later on, especially with breast cancer, start helping. I think they had learned that through the first woman that had called and how that had grew.
The community itself, because Linda, you talked about before how, and other people have talked about how the newspaper helped to strengthen that community. And AIDS is one of the ways, but also now you're describing cancer and so forth. But do you think it was the AIDS epidemic, which I think it's an epidemic, it was an epidemic, that the newspaper helped solidify that community behind the work?
I think it broadened it.
I think it definitely had. It just made all of us step up to the plate, and you just had to learn a lot quickly and be supportive. And the articles that we wrote would get people interested in things, and they would call the writer, or if it was Elizabeth that wrote something, they'd call her, and she'd get them going on a project.
And there were people, it found all the people who didn't go to the bars.
Yeah, yes.
Oh my gosh, there was even gay AA came along, and lesbian AA, and you could find out where that was. I thought one of the most amazing things of the paper, though, was the sports world, the gay sports world. Yeah. That was just amazing.
We had sports pages, and you know, I designed a paper just like the Sacramento Bee, and you know, that's why CK was so important. But sports was a big thing. That we had softball leagues, and then when the Olympics happened, golf started happening, and just all the organizations started happening, and each sport. Volleyball, it was just everything.
So many people came in into the sports because, you know, that was something they could do. Oh, and then there were the gay fathers.
Yeah. gay fathers that had kids.
Gay fathers that had kids, yes.
That was one of our first organizations in our big list of gay organizations was Gay Fathers.
And a lot of that was pre-AIDS, so it was working to enlarge the community and outreach even before AIDS. But by the time HIV was, everybody was reading the paper. You know, you waited for it to come out. You went and found it. You know, it was in newsstands all over. And people just, we anxiously awaited it. Well, we had a wonderful nurse who volunteered, who got it from a needle stick. Mm-hmm. And went out and took care. Oh, she was wonderful. She took Joan. She went out and she took care of AIDS patients. She lost her job because she got HIV from a needle stick. They didn't want her at Kaiser or Mercy at that time. Hmm. And here's this person with all this nursing love in her, and she came and volunteered, and she went out and did practical support and took care of people. She was great. And then she started putting on the fight for safer needles, you know, for nurses, which they have now. We were hesitant to put those out there for a while because they were expensive, but...
You know, just Patty, I just can't remember her last name, but she had a little golf cart, and she was decorated as a condom.
Oh, Patty. Yeah, Patty.
And so she, at functions, she either somebody would go pick up the golf cart and her in a truck and take it to these fairs and wherever people were gathering. And
you know, all I remember, I just remember whenever we had events, the tree would show up. Do you remember the tree? It looked like a pine tree, and he'd stand in the corner and you wouldn't know it was a person. And it'd get me every year. We had potlucks once a month for the volunteers and the people with AIDS and the clients who all became intermixed, and they were huge gatherings. We'd be over at St. Francis
is where the hand-to-hand project was there.
And then we went to a Lutheran church. It was a conservative Lutheran church, too, and they let us be there. And I remember Ann Rudin coming to say hello to everybody, and that was really nice. And everybody dressed up at Halloween, and... Yeah. I had a little Bichon Frise dog that would work the potlucks, learn to sit up and beg. And so those were joyful times. I don't know, I think, you know, when I look at my life, I think that was probably my life's purpose and why I was put here, was to do what I did.
Yeah.
You know, that's the good thing about it. I feel like I fulfilled a purpose in life that was significant.
Yeah, because you were here before it started, you know, and so you had to pick up the ball.
Yeah, yeah.
Run with it.
Yeah. You did.
You know, after losing the paper, I went through a lot of deep depression, and that was really hard, and I couldn't shake it. And actually, it's you that pulled me out of it. Your letter to me, you know, asking to have the archives, it just gave me a project, and then I just started hearing how important the paper was to people, you know, because when you're isolated and you're just home and you're just doing things with friends, you don't hear all the stories. And so
you don't know that you're a pioneer.
Yeah.
Well, that's a bad term.
Yeah.
So, you're an innovator?
Something I was.
It was such a good paper. Such a good paper.